Side 3.
As we conclude this section on timing, let me just reiterate one or two of the points. First of all, when you take a long view as to your investment strategies, it's much simpler than riding the roller coaster in the front end. And the way to take a long view is to look at the emotions and feelings of the marketplace. One exercise I like to do sometimes is to clip out newspaper articles or TV news stories or radio bulletins and so on about a particular, let's say, product or commodity or share, and see what the pundits are saying about that share, because they very much influence the way a market will go. And you can look at, let's say, all of your newspaper clippings in relation to, let's say, gold shares, and you more or less count, hey, how many say it's going up and how many say it's going down? And then you look at the consciousness of the market and you see what is the trend here. By riding behind a trend or following a trend once it has been established, you can be in the profit of the event rather than being at the front end, which is much more bumpy. And so it isn't that hard for you to sort of come up with areas to invest or areas to negotiate in or areas to be a part of where you only have to discover, let's say, the general trend rather than the moment-by-moment changes. In the early part of 86, it seemed almost certain that the platinum prices in the world would go up. And if you'd been an investor that time and you had the information regarding the platinum market, you would have had half a dozen sort of basic fundamentals that would have told you that sooner or later the consciousness would shift and prices would begin to move upwards. At that time, South Africa was coming under tremendous sort of social turmoil and problems with the racial conditions down there. And of course, South Africa is one of the major platinum producers of the world. There was also an underproduction of platinum, and there were many, let's say, thousands of ounces a year more demand than there was supply. At the same time, the US dollar was weakening, and because of the US government's high deficit that they were running and their disinclination to tax the people, you could have more or less said, if you watched the general consciousness of the platinum market, hey, this platinum is bound to go up sooner or later. If you'd bought on that understanding and held on for 6 to 8 months, you would have made a tremendous profit. And so again, we're looking at timing, of understanding that you're looking at an overall strategy for timing rather than a moment-by-moment positioning in regards to what it is you're doing. One of the reasons I think that, for example, governments don't work, you know, whether it's the Australian government or any other government in the world, is that governments only hold power for a few years at a time. The destiny or the well-being of a country runs over generation to generation. But the time frames that, say, for example, the government has are so tight that they kind of negotiate themselves into a box where they have to perform, let's say, in a very short period of time. And of course, if they do things that are unpopular in that period, they'll be voted out of office. And so when you're looking at timing, you're looking at basically creating that whole feeling inside of you that you have all of the time in the world. The other thing that I just want to mention in conclusion of the whole discussion on timing is that I genuinely believe that it is never, ever wrong to take a profit. Even if the profit you take disengages you from a downline profit or from a larger profit later on, you know, once you have a fairly reasonable profit in a deal, I don't think it's wrong to take that profit, because it frees up your capital or it frees up your time or your creativity to make money elsewhere. As we move on from T as in timing, let us now move into the I of information. Obviously, information in a negotiation, in life, is a vital psychological step. Once you have information, you have power. And so as you move through life, whether you're dealing with interpersonal relationships or you're, you know, dealing in a business situation or even in a corporate situation, you have to basically research the terrain. So often we plow into things without really knowing what it is we're going to be getting into. And sometimes if a deal is complex, it's hard for you to think out all of the ramifications, all of the possibilities, all of the what-ifs. And yet, if you don't pencil those what-ifs out, you can quite often think you're getting into one deal and down line find yourself contractually obligated to something totally different. As you look at life, you need to go into it with an action plan, with a battle plan, and you need to really understand where am I committing my troops and what are my possibilities for losses and what are my possibilities for profit. We go in blind. We put our money into things without really having a clue where it's going. How many of you, say, for example, have money in a bank or with a stockbroker or with an investment house, a unit trust, a credit union of one kind or another, where you know absolutely nothing about that bank? You know, they will have, let's say, a plaque on the wall that says the La-Di-Da Bank. But what do you know about that bank? You know, who runs the bank? What are their balance sheets? What are their assets? Where are their loans? I mean, have they lent $1 billion to some Mickey Mouse nation that's never going to give it back? Or what? And yet somehow we always accept the status quo. And just because the plaque on the door says, you know, we are the such and such company, we presume them to be solid and sturdy. And history proves that there are millions of companies all over the world that look solid right up to the moment when they go bankrupt. And so as you look for the information, any time that you're prepared to spend at the front end looking at or discovering everything that you can know about a deal will serve you greatly at the back end. As we go into a negotiation, obviously the opposition hide their true needs, their true strategies. And that's the point where you have to use your subtlety or your craftiness to gather the information that you need. Usually that can come from all sorts of various sources. You can look it up in the company records. You can discover it by talking to other people that are in the same business. Often you can get information from employees in a corporation, from secretaries, from warehousemen, from drivers. You can talk to accountants. You can talk to lawyers. There's all sorts of people that will give you the information you want. And by working or putting in that time, it allows you to stand in the high ground. Obviously, if you knew what the opposition were thinking, it would help you tremendously. And you can begin to teach yourself to understand what they're thinking by watching them in the negotiation and watching their feelings, watching the subtle messages that they give off. Not only, say, for example, the body language that they express as they're talking to you, but little things, maybe, for example, like how their eyes move, you know, when you mention their price, or the way, let's say, a person leans back from a table or leans in, what they do with their hands, the way they're dressed, the way they're seated, which person in the negotiation is doing most of the talking, have they raised their voice, have they lowered their voice. And as you begin to hunt for the subtle meanings of things, then all of a sudden, there's all sorts of information in there that may be immensely useful to you. One of the things that I teach people is in telephone conversations, it's important to listen to the silences rather than the talking. The talking will have the official printout, the official story, that part that the person who's talking to you wants to convey to you as being his position or her position. However, in the silences, there's often information about how they actually feel. And quite often when we speak or when we talk to each other, we tend to cover up our true needs or our true hidden feelings. When you can discern what the needs of an individual are, then you have all of these like psychological points to begin to bargain with. Quite often what a person wants is not more money or a better price for a building or a better price for a product. They often need acknowledgement, or they need to be reassured, or they need some kind of guarantee, or they need to feel more secure, or they just need to be told that they're a neat person. Hey, you're a good guy, you know? And that's all they need to hear. And so as we look at, like, let's say, for example, conflict resolution, or we look at like dealing with staff members, it's always important to probe with questions. And the questions can be reasonably innocuous at the front end so that a person doesn't put up their guard or doesn't put up their defenses, and they can become more pertinent or more personal as you move into the conversation. And so what you would do is you would ask some sort of general pieces of information that you probably know the answer to anyway, and then gradually when you get the person used to responding to your questions, you will begin to ask more and more pertinent questions, beginning to look for the pain in their life. I know that perhaps might sound like a dramatic way of describing a person's needs, but when you're looking at, or when you ask yourself the question, what is the pain, or what is the discomfort, or what is the hurt in this person's life, you can move very, very quickly to the point of the negotiation, or the point that they want, or the thing that they actually want. And so you're looking to try to discover, what does the information in this situation tell me? The mind is programmed to basically cut out about 80% of all the information that comes to it as being unnecessary. As you begin to demand of your mind to notice everything, your peripheral awareness begins to increase, and you begin to develop an intuitive sense about what is going on in the world. As you demand of your mind to notice everything, as you demand that it gives you all of the information in any one given situation, it begins to pick up subtle pieces of information that transcend logic. And so you'll be listening to a person telling you one thing, and you'll be able to tell inside the feelings of that person or inside the intuition that you have about the situation what it is they actually want or what it is they actually mean. When you go into, let's say, an organization, or you go into a factory to make a sale, or you go into an office building, there are all sorts of clues about that company the minute you walk in. You can immediately detect whether the company is, let's say, organized or disorganized. Is the corporation, let's say, financially sound? I mean, does it have a feeling of being well off? Or does it have a feeling of, like, you know, money's tight or things are a bit skimped in one way or another? The other thing that you can begin to discern is, like, the level of stress. Is there a tremendous amount of stress? Are the staff running around like chickens with their heads cut off? Or is the situation calm and together and centered? And the same thing as when you're doing business with another person. You can soon tell whether or not they are under stress. And if they are under stress, you can begin to, like, lob in little innocuous questions that say things like, oh gosh, you seem to be really busy, don't you? And they come back to you and they go, yeah, right, crack, yeah, I'm run off my feet, you know? And you can begin to get them to talk about their life. Most people love to talk about their life. They love to talk about their reality, their circumstances, their knowledge, their wit, their cleverness, their brilliance, their stupidities, or whatever it is. And so it's not hard to begin to get the opposition to disclose a whole bunch of information before you have actually said anything, okay? And when we look at the psychology of negotiation that we'll handle next, one of the things that we're going to look at is the use of silence. But as you begin to demand of your mind to give you information, you can train it to notice everything. One of the little exercises that I suggest you do is walk down the street and see how much of that scene you can remember, notice, and retain. And you might have a friend walk with you, and you walk 10 paces down the street, and then you scan to your left, and you scan to your right, and then have your friend ask you questions. What was the color of the lady's dress that crossed the street? There were two dogs there. What type of dogs were they? What was the registration number of the van that went past? How many traffic lights? How many buildings? How many people? What was the noise? And you begin to collect information. Okay, at the beginning, this information is useless to you. You really don't need to know how many dogs were on the street when you walked past. But by demanding of your mind to notice everything, you begin to align yourself to the subtlety. And what you're looking at is, you're looking at coming out of a heightened awareness, an awareness that is more acute than the people that you're dealing with. By now, you're already coming out of a bigger energy because you've got a better self-image, you know where you're going, you feel assured, you feel detached, you feel all of this power around you. But by slipping in this heightened sense of perception and by training yourself to notice things and to enhance your peripheral vision, your peripheral hearing, you're becoming this acutely sensitive being that understands the motivations, understands the undercurrents of energy that are flowing through any given situation, whether it's a negotiation or a romantic entanglement or whatever it may be. The thing is that as you develop a heightened perception, it's important to let the other people know that you have that perception, because it puts them literally off their guard and it makes them slightly uneasy because they don't know what it is that you actually know. And it isn't very hard to let people know that you have an acute perception. One of the techniques you may want to say is, or you may want to use is, when somebody gives you a point, let's say they say something like, well, you know, we've been having rather a lot of trouble with the supplies coming in from the north. You can just sit there and sort of go, yes, I know. And they may then go on to say, of course, and the way we feel about this is such and such and such and such. And you say, yes, I know. Obviously, you didn't necessarily know. But when you say that, yes, I know, they think to themselves, wait a minute, what does this person know and what don't they know? And it leaves them thinking that you know a hell of a lot more than perhaps you do know about a situation, and that again gives you the psychological high ground. When you deal with information, you can understand that, of course, information is negotiable. The stuff you know, you can swap for some of the stuff they know. And the name of the game is to get the opposition to give you some vital piece of information by swapping them something that is less vital to you. Collecting information can be bothersome. It can be a drag to have to go do the research. But of course, it's vital. And also, in collecting the information, you have to go beyond your discomfort of prying into other people's affairs. However, as you come out of that individuality, you're not going to care whether they react or don't react. What you're going to say is, listen, if you want me to do this deal, I need to have all of this information. Please supply it. If they won't supply it, then again, they are telling you something in their not supplying it. And they are telling you, basically, warning, warning, and you're going to want to know, why won't these people give me the information that I need? As we work with that and as we look at that, we can understand that it's hard for us to, let's say, call another person on their honesty or call them on, let's say, the trust. For example, you'll go into a corporation and they'll say something to you like, well, we've been here 20 years and we're known to be sound and trustworthy people, and so we can't understand why you're asking to look at our balance sheets or why you're asking us for credit references or the name of our bank. And the way to get around that is to say to them, I do trust you. And I respect the reputation of your corporation. However, my accountant insists that I run all of these details past him before he allows me to make an investment. Or you can use your husband or your wife, and you can say, well, I can't buy this house without my wife looking at the details. And so you can always shift their responsibility for the prying or for the information gathering to some almost anonymous party someplace else that will take the blame for the fact that you're being a pain in the neck wanting to know 1,000 things. As we deal with this whole aspect of information, we constantly move into this uncomfortableness of asking people to, like, prove to us that they will follow through. As you look at the world today, reality is moving faster and faster. It's like harder and harder to maintain. It's harder and harder to keep up. Many, many people out there are literally struggling to make ends meet, or they're struggling to sustain a level of enthusiasm and a level of energy that is apropos to this market that we exist in today. And so constantly people will fall short. They will contract to do something because in their mind they feel that they can live up to it. And yet when they actually follow through, they do something that is less than best or less than they agreed to do. And so the name of the game there is to get them to place their obligation in writing to you. And sometimes that can be very hard, because as you say to somebody, well, I would like it in writing, they come back to you with, well, don't you trust me? And then you have to say, look, again, I trust you fine, but, you know, my accountant insists it's in writing, or my wife insists that it is in writing. The other thing to do in that case is to play dumb and say, well, you know, the reason I need it in writing is that I've got a terrible memory and I tend to forget what the hell these agreements are. And so if we have it in writing, there won't be any disagreement and I won't underpay you and we'll know exactly where we're going. Say, for example, a guy comes along and he agrees to paint your house for $1,000. If you don't define what it is that he is actually going to do for you, more than likely you won't get all that you expect for your $1,000. And so you need to jot down in writing how many coats of paint, how much time is he going to take stripping off the old paint, making good, is he going to use a coat of primer, what kind of paint, is he going to finish off, what is he going to do with the rubbish that's left over, is he going to pay to haul it away, or are you going to have to pay to haul it away, and so on. And it's a simple point of just being real with people and not being manipulated into, like, their reactions. And so as you look at information, it's good to A, do the research in the front end, 2, know that the information you have is valuable, 3, heighten your perception so that you notice everything and you get used to being able to sort of understand almost clairvoyantly or using your feelings or your intuition to understand what the underlying current is, and understand that the information you have is a commodity that you can sell within the negotiation, and to bring the people or bring the negotiators or the deal makers in whatever deal it is into a contractual arrangement, and to go beyond the difficulty of calling people. If a person, and when I mean calling them, I mean calling them on what they say they are. If a person says, I'm a doctor, there's no reason why you can't say, well, can I see your certificate? Or if a person says, I'm an investment counselor, you say, well, that's great. You know, what do you know about investments? Where did you train? What have you done? What are your references? You know, show me some of the results that you have produced for other people, and so on. And as you begin to learn to do that, it'll become just a natural part of how you go through life. And it'll make your life simpler and you'll spend less time being in confrontations with people, there won't be conflicts, and there won't be that lousy feeling of having been ripped off, you know, where like you've gone into a deal and somebody said they're going to supply something at a certain time at a certain place and they just didn't supply it. And you think to yourself, what an idiot I was, you know, that I didn't get that in writing, or I didn't define what the deal was, or I allowed myself to be suckered into paying for something that I didn't get. And so in that whole informational thing, again, you're moving into this negotiation or you're moving into this transaction slowly. You're taking time to know exactly what is going on. You've sent scouts out to the high ground and they can tell you exactly what the valley looks like, what the positions are of the opposing team and so on. And you're not committing your troops into a trap, into a blind alley. And I think that's really, really important. Finally, as we look at information, don't be afraid to use disinformation or misinformation. And when I say that, I don't mean be sneaky and downright lie. But reality is subjective. We all have a different reality. We can look at a film and we'll all come out with a different opinion about that film. And so when you're negotiating with people, you can bring in little sort of like sniping activities that create a sort of an uncertainty or an imbalance for the opposition. So somebody can say to you, well, this refrigerator is $500. And you can say, well, I've seen this refrigerator on sale for $395. And so there you are. You're using information which may not necessarily be 100% accurate, but it is your reality. And after all, the $500 that they're asking for the refrigerator may not be 100% accurate either. It is, again, only their reality. And so we're looking at, like, using information in sort of a loose way, misinformation or disinformation, in a way of, like, sniping at the strength of the opposition's position. Again, I don't think that you want to be, like, sneaky about it, but I don't know. I always think that it's neat to have a few of those little sort of mortar shells up your sleeve to allow you to create an expectancy which will be slightly less than the expectancy that the opposition holds as absolute reality. The other thing that you may want to use from time to time are those magical words people say. And so when a person says to you, say, for example, the market in refrigerators seems to be hardening and the price is going up, you can come back with, well, people tell me or people say that, in fact, there's a glut of refrigerators in this country and that the Taiwanese are dropping them in at the rate of a million a day. The beautiful thing about that whole phrase, people say or people tell me, is that somehow you collect or you gather strength from the sort of the collectiveness of it. In other words, if you say, I think that the market in refrigerators is softening and the Taiwanese are importing them in here or exporting them here at a million a day, it doesn't sound so good as, you know, people tell me, or I read the other day in the business journal or whatever. It grants you sort of like a collective strength. And so it puts the opposition in a position where they have their reality, but, oh gosh, all of a sudden there's a million people out there that are aware of the fact that the Taiwanese are dumping refrigerators at a million refrigerators a day. And so little sort of subtle techniques like that, as you use information, these subtle nuances, you can begin to kind of erode or undermine the reality of the other person. And again, you're not doing it to sort of beat them up or to sort of hurt them as a person, but you're doing it to establish an alternative reality, an alternative philosophy. And the philosophy basically says, I don't want to pay for this refrigerator a penny more than I really have to. And after all, you don't have to. I mean, there's no written law up there in the sky that says you got to pay $500 for that fridge. You can pay for that fridge any price that anyone will give it to you for. And so it's just a way of like using information to your own ends, you know? It'd be neat, say, for example, as you walked into the refrigerator store, if you had a clipping that said, Taiwan sends a million refrigerators to Australia every day. And so when the guy tells you about the market hardening, out comes this clipping and you're already ready for that point. And so you're looking at creating or working with information, again, maneuvering to the high ground. I think what's important is that you can use the information in a vague way, or you can bend reality a little bit to suit your ends. And as long as you're not harming somebody or you're not, you know, doing them down in some way, it stays within the bounds of morality. I think one of the most important things in life is to become crafty. And of course, when you say to people, oh, you need to become crafty, they have this sort of emotional reaction. They sort of think that like crafty means like becoming some kind of con man or fraudulent person that's going to go and rip people off. But crafty is so much a matter of like the craft of humanhood. It's the craft of understanding the psychology of events, the craft of like being in a position where you are in the right place at the right time, of understanding the ramifications of what you're going into because you've taken time to solicit the information, craftiness in allowing yourself an exit so that you can get out if you don't want to, craftiness in being there positioned in the timing of things. And so I would like you to like look at your life in that sort of crafty way. In any given situation, you need to ask yourself the question, does this situation nurture me? Is this situation designed to benefit me? Is this situation, you know, to my liking? What do I get out of it? If I obligate in this area, what do I get out of that obligation? If I'm committed here emotionally, what do I get back? And it isn't wrong to look after yourself, or it isn't wrong to evaluate your life in relation to the circumstances of your life. Because in the end, if you look after yourself and you concentrate upon yourself, it makes your life more beautiful and more interesting to live. It makes you freer. It makes you less harassed, more calm, more in control of yourself. And in the end, you can love the world and you can serve the world as a better person. And so I think it's very, very important to whenever you're dealing with the circumstances of life, to evaluate them and to look at it and to not be embarrassed to say, what do I get out of this? And you'll find that many of your actions and many of the things you've committed yourself to, you get absolutely nothing out of it at all. And you do it for 101 various reasons that may have a legitimacy or may not have a legitimacy. And so as you get into the habit of like evaluating and scanning and sifting and reevaluating, you get into this habit of being in touch with what is going on. You're in touch with the informational input in your life, and you can understand the health and the well-being of your life circumstances or the sickness, disease, difficulty. As you look at life, you look at all of these people out there that are so pressurized and so harassed and so out of control. What you're looking to do is to design a lifestyle where you are in balance, where you're in the center of the circle and life is coming to you, where your negotiations are flowing, where the whole psychology of life is designed to assist you to get those things you want with like minimum effort. You're looking at like maximum effectiveness with minimum effort. As you look at your day, you'll find that 80% of your day is like rushing around and it doesn't get you any money. 20% of your efforts usually get you 80% of your cash. And 80% of your efforts get you 20% of your cash or nothing at all. And so as you're looking at becoming a more concerted, more concentrated being, you're looking at cutting out those things that are superfluous to your requirements, taking in the information, evaluating it, and making all of your moves effective, making everything that you do powerful and meaningful. And so all of a sudden, a whole bunch of time and information is there to be used, and you can distribute your energy, you just distribute your workload, your effort, your recreation, your interpersonal relationships, so they have this maximum impact. It is almost like you're squashing in reality so that you get more out of the hours that you have in the day. And that's important, because as you begin to work with it, then all of a sudden the whole of life seems to take on a meaning. It becomes a symbol of the inner you, and things flow and they're organized and they show up at the right time and money flows and the bills are paid, and you feel this sense of being centered, being like concerted or concentrated, you know where you're going, you've thought it through, and there you are, this compact individual that is not like wandering around in TikTok unaware of what the heck's going on, but this very perceptive individual that is experiencing evolution, experiencing life to his or her maximum potential. And that, I think, is the vital key to all of this. The vital key to your transcendence, to your understanding, and to your gradual improvement, so you become more and more an expert. And as you become an expert, then the whole psychology of life automatically reveals itself to you. And that will allow you an additional high ground, an additional advantage over those people that are wandering around in this kind of state of sort of mild slumber, which describes most of humanity.
This is the end of the side. Please fast forward. Side 4.
As we look at the word prophet and the letters symbolizing each one of the aspects that you want to take into the negotiations or your, let's say, contractual obligations through life, we've looked at F for feet, the detachment, the fluidity, I for information, which is basically your power source, and T for timing. For obviously, if you have all the time in the world to conclude a deal, you're already on the psychological high ground. Now let us look at the first three letters of the word. P for the psychology of negotiating, R for the relationships that you have to create in order for negotiations to be successful, and O for the originality that you will bring, this alternative philosophy or this oblique view, looking for like clever ways or original ways to make the deal come together. If you look at the psychology, your very, very best tool and your number one power source in the psychology of negotiation is in fact to not negotiate, to remain silent. It is almost as if the person who opens his mouth first loses. And so when you're discussing a deal, you need to sit quietly and listen to what the other person has to say and say as little as possible. Try to avoid the need to be clever or to come up with some bright remark or to sort of try to exhibit how marvelous you are, or how much money you've made or how big a salary you negotiated last time or whatever it may be. When you keep quiet, the opposition creates thoughts for you. They create what they think you're thinking. And when people think you're thinking something, they always grant you much more power than you usually exhibit. And so when a person turns to you, let's say you're going out and buying a house, and they turn to you and they say, what do you think of the price? You don't say, well, I don't like the price, or I do like the price, or it's a bit high, it's a bit low. All you do is remain silent. And being silent can make them incredibly uncomfortable. And if you're not used to maintaining silence, it may make you uncomfortable. And so do it from time to time, just to experiment in going past the discomfort. For example, next time somebody asks you a question, let's say a guy stops you in the street and says, what is the time? Don't answer him. Just look at him and say nothing. And see how long it is before he walks away. He may think you're deaf, and he may think you're an idiot, and he may think you're mentally deficient. But it allows you to go beyond the uncomfortableness of not responding. So, when a person says to you, what do you think of the price of the house? You just remain silent. And if you say anything at all, you turn around and you say, the hinge is missing on the gate. Or the house is too tall, or the house is not tall enough. And so by keeping silent, you're not basically allowing a person any entry into your feelings or any entry into your position. As they talk, if you need to talk or if you need to keep the conversation going, then use that time to psychologically make them important. Everybody wants to feel special. Everybody wants to feel important. And so if you have to open your mouth, you can open your mouth to like basically rub their ego. You can praise them or acknowledge them, or you can basically let them hear what it is that they want to hear. Life is a game, and that's all it is. And there's a way of running through life where you can have this whole comedy of watching everybody fall over themselves as you come past. And the name of the game is always to retain your perceptions, to retain who you are within yourself, and not come out of overt strength. Okay, sometimes it works to bang your fist on the table and storm out. And of course, that on rare occasions, that will work as a tactics. You know, if you come out of anger or you raise your voice. But almost like 9 times out of 10, that tactic doesn't work because it just creates in the other people a defensive response, or they get insulted, or they become sort of like structured in their belief patterns, and they begin to sort of like they dive down a hole and shut the hatch. What you're looking to do in your negotiations and in your emotional interactions with people is basically play dumb. You know, people love to help people that are dumb. I mean, the greatest way to move into a negotiation is to have the other people think that you know nothing about it. And then as you come out of this, like, please help me, I'm this poor, helpless person, I don't understand it, I don't know what I'm doing, they will give you all of the information and assistance that they want to give you. As you solicit that help from them, you suck them into a relationship. And we'll talk about R for relationships in a moment. So basically, often your best tactics is to hide your knowledge, to hide your power, and that way, A, you can suck the people into helping you, to giving you this information. You can suck them into thinking that like they're like aiding you, like sort of helping a little old dear across the street. And also, if you come out of being too bloody clever, too bloody shrewd, then the opposition gets defensive. You know, they can see that you're crafty, they can see that you're shrewd, and they think, wait a minute, if we give away too much here, this person's going to eat us alive, you know, they're going to eat our lunch. And so you're looking at trying to create a subtle balance between knowing where you're going, but not necessarily letting the other people know. Of course, on some occasions, it's important that you actually establish your credentials because that helps you, let's say, maintain status quo. But that's usually in the case that when you're a seller rather than a buyer. And so if you have some super-duper credentials and you're a lawyer or you're an accountant or you're the vice president of this and that, then in those situations, you just want to mention it. You don't have to tell people how marvelous you are, how crafty you are, how clever you are, how you beat up on somebody else in a previous negotiation. But it's neat to get it out on the table. Hey, I'm a qualified accountant. So then at least the opposition knows that you're not an idiot and you can add two and two or, you know, whatever your qualification is. So you can come up with that idea or you can come across with that whole thought form of like establishing your credentials, but don't come out of being a smart aleck. The other thing is that when you're in a negotiation and they establish their credentials and they say to you, this is the world famous consultant on refrigerator prices who presented a paper to the United Nations on what refrigerators cost, at that point you begin to sort of snipe at that credential or you sort of begin to sort of work that credential down a little bit so that they're not using that to establish a status quo that they're going to flip you with. And so you would say something like, oh, well, I appreciate that you're an expert in refrigerators and you presented a paper at the United Nations on refrigerator prices. But isn't it true that, like, the world nowadays is so complex and so, you know, difficult to understand and things are changing so fast that the refrigerator market is infinitely more complex than it used to be? And whereas there was only 20 refrigerator makers 20 years ago, now there's many thousands. And, of course, refrigerator prices are moving by the minute, aren't they? And so you begin to kind of, like, erode their base or their status quo and you begin to establish yours. Okay, as you begin to move into this transaction or this negotiation, if you have silence as an integral part of your power source, then you're never going to define your needs or your options until you have to. And you're never going to define your needs in a negotiation until you've discovered what their needs are. And so you may say to them, okay, let us clear all of this stuff out of the way and let us really get to the nitty-gritty of what's going on here. You tell me what you guys need and I'll tell you what I need. But first you have them tell you what their needs are because once you know what their needs are, you may want to adjust your position. And so as you're looking for that, you're looking for like swapping, but you swap second, not first. And so the silence will allow you to think through what it is you're going to say. And how many times have we like blurted out something in a negotiation that we never meant to say? Or we've agreed, you know, where somebody says it's $120,000 for this house. If you go, oh yes, just in the word yes, you're confirming that reality. And so you keep silent and you change the subject. You never, never, never mouth or word their price structure. If their price structure is $120,000, you don't say, oh, $120,000 sounds too much or too little. You just keep quiet. And by keeping quiet, you move them off of certainty into uncertainty. And you move them into wondering what the hell you're thinking. And you move them into having to disclose their needs and their options before you disclose any part of where you're coming from. The name of the game, obviously, is to break down their expectations. And so when you talk about that house, as they mention $120,000, you start talking about $80,000 houses or $80,000. Or when this deal is concluded, the $80,000 that we will give you will di-di-di-di-di or whatever the information is. And so you begin to establish a reality close to or slightly under what it is you are actually prepared to pay. So you begin to move them off and don't be embarrassed to have a price structure or a reality position that is diametrically opposed to theirs.
They have their reality, remember? You have your own reality. And then as they express their reality and they tell you about all the good points about this house and why you should buy it, you need to constantly bring in your reality and explain to them that really the kitchen seems rather small, or the hinge on the gate is missing, or the house is too low or too high or not green or is green or should be white or isn't white or whatever it is. But you're beginning to establish a powerful sense of my reality is very strong. Your reality is strong also, but changeable. And that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to move them off. As you move them off and you understand the psychology of security and insecurity, don't be afraid to use like emotion or guilt or honor to maneuver them to where you want to maneuver them. Realize that they are going to react in usually the traditional patterns. And in a way, they're going to want to react usually to please you or at least to give you what you need, because that's how humans are. They want you to love them. They want you to accept them. They want you to think they're clever and bright. And so you can use that to get them into a position that you want to get them into. Remember, of course, that most people come out of the morality of TikTok. They come out of the standard emotions, the standard belief patterns, the standard ways of doing things. And so it isn't usually very hard to appeal to them, to their emotional honor or their guilt, or to appeal to them to maintain the status quo. And you can use all of that to create this sense of, well, this is the way that things are done, is it not? Or this is the price that is generally paid, is it not? And you can get them, you can maneuver them within the restriction of their own limitation. And the restriction of their own limitation is all the stuff, all the garbage that they've hauled through life that they believe to be real. As you're coming out of an alternative philosophy, you can create or use the imprisonment or the fence that they live in, the smallness of their mind or the smallness of, let's say, their experience of life or their psychological understanding of life, to box them into a position where, because of their own guilt or because of their own honor or because of their own emotional tenants, they will not be able to maneuver themselves out of it. And so you can kind of like logic them back into that position, or you can like have them step back. It's not so much that you're manipulating them, it's more that you're using their own belief patterns, their own ego, their own persona, to allow them to trap themselves or to restrict themselves. And so by using that or playing off the status quo, you can allow them or you can force them to drop into a position that they may perhaps not be able to get out of. The other thing in negotiating that I think is very important is that you have to come out of humility. Everybody likes people to be weak or to be humble. And so whereas you may not necessarily feel that humble, in fact, you might be very pleased with your successes in life, you need to come out of that humbleness. When I was working as a clothing jobber in London, my partner taught me to be very, very humble and very, very polite in all the negotiations that we went into. And so we were constantly calling people yes, sir, and no, ma'am, and all that sort of stuff, and good morning, and how do you do, and how do you please. And at the beginning, it was rather sort of unnatural. I thought, why are we going through all of this theatrics? But I could see down line how incredibly important it was to be humble and to be very, very polite, especially when there were emotional reactions from the other people as to what price we wanted to pay for, say, a job lot of jeans. As you learn to lay your energy underneath people, it supports them, first of all, and it allows their ego to come out of, like, feeling good. My old partner, David, on the first negotiation I ever went into, suddenly started laying on the floor of this guy's office. And so I'm sitting in the chair, and the other guy, you know, the guy we were negotiating with was sitting behind the desk, and my partner, who was a colossal man, I mean, he was like 6'4" and about 200 or 250 pounds, suddenly got off his chair and started lying on the floor, leaning up, talking on one elbow. And I was watching him doing it, and as he was doing it, he kind of looked at me and sort of signaled with his eyes for me to get on the floor. So I got on the floor, and the fellow we were doing this negotiating with had to more or less like lean across the desk to watch these two guys like crawling around on the carpet. And after we successfully negotiated this deal and we're back out in the car park, I said to David, I said, what the hell was all that like lying on the floor for? And David said, that's all part of the subtlety of like getting underneath the other person. It's like when you're lying on the floor, you're no threat to that person. It is almost like you've subjugated yourself literally and physically underneath their energy. And then you can come out of an oblique subtlety that grants you, let's say, a strength that they don't realize you have. I've noticed people play the same trick with children. If a small child is crying and you stand over it and you say, "Don't cry," it cries all the louder because it wants you to attend to it. It wants attention. The trick is to, like, crawl down onto the ground and look up at the child and then ask it not to cry. And suddenly, rather than you being the parent and it being the child, it becomes a parent and you're the child and it feels responsible for you and stops crying. And I've watched people use this technique, you know, and 9 times out of 10 it actually works, where you've subjugated your energy or you've subjugated yourself to the other person by being humble. It's not like you're giving away any of your power, and it's not like as if you're coming out of weak. It's just you've almost like created this sort of Taoist philosophy of like being underneath, you know, the lowest point being the strongest point. The Taoists always believed and revered in the energy of water because they said that water flowed to the lowest point. It always took the lowest position or it went to the low ground. And so here we are, this person that's incredibly bright, they have all this information going for themselves, but they come out of a humility, come out of a politeness, come out of a silence, come out of knowing the subtlety of getting underneath the opposition and allowing the opposition to feel not threatened. When people feel secure, they open up their hearts to you. When they open up their hearts to you, you know what they need. When you know what they need, you've won the psychological battle in the negotiation. When you're a seller, then, of course, you have to create razzmatazz. You have to create emotion, thought form, a whole theatrics around what it is that you're selling. You can use rarity value. You can use charisma. You can use mystery. You can use glamour. And I think that's important because we tend to forget to come out of glamour. Many of you are very, very glamorous. Maybe you're not necessarily that beautiful to look at, but you have charisma, the way you dress, the way you walk through a room, the way you talk. And when you come out of glamour, when you come out of success, when you come out of mystery and charisma, people want to join. It's like everybody likes to hang out with a film star. And so when you come off glamour and you see yourself as good-looking, as glamorous, as being this quiet, silent strength, it's almost like you win over the opposition right from the very off. And that allows you, again, to take one more position or one more place where your battalions are stationed in a good position in the valley. As you look at the deal, as you understand what's going on, then you can use your certainty within yourself to take risks, to look at the creative aspects of a deal and to weigh them up in the light of your knowledge, in the light of, hey, what are my losses? What are my profits? And you can use that to maneuver the whole position for yourself. As you look at the psychology of negotiation, don't be afraid to use like reward and punishment. Especially when you're dealing with interpersonal relationships. Let's say, for example, if you're talking to an employee about his request for a pay rise or whatever, you can use the power that you have. I think it's important not to become one of the great manipulators. The world is full of people manipulating everybody else. And I don't know that you would want to join the ranks of those people. But you can sort of say to people, hey, if you do this and this, you get this. If you don't follow through on your contract, you wind up paying a penalty. And you can use that to get everybody clear about what it is they're going to deliver. Because, of course, people don't like to be real. They don't like to deliver. They don't like to follow through. They don't like to be committed. As you look at this whole psychology, you're going to have tenacity and you're going to have patience. If you're prepared to wait, if you have that tenacious spirit where you're prepared to wait to look for the right deal, you're prepared to wait for like everybody to dissipate their emotions in and around a deal, in and around a price structure, in and around certain negotiating points, the tenacity that you express stands inside your heart as this great strength. And they feel that. They feel that you're consistent. They feel you're strong. And that forces them to alter their position in relation to you. As you look at any given situation, there will always be what I call power points. You know, if you go into a restaurant, there are power points in the restaurant. There are places that are stronger than others. There are positions that are stronger than others. There are times of the day that are stronger than others. If you go into a bank, say, and you go in the first 2 hours of Monday morning and you want to negotiate a loan, that's not a strong time because the loan officer that you're going to be talking to will have come off the weekend thinking about all the obligations he has on Monday morning, and suddenly you jump into his frame of reality and you're bringing in something something that's like extraneous to his needs. Friday afternoon is a lousy time as well. That's not a PowerPoint in a week either, because the man or the woman that works at the bank, you know, in their mind, they were already gone to the beach. You know, they've gone fishing. And here you are trying to get $1 million to buy a block of flats, and their mind is someplace else. In any one given situation, you think to yourself, hey, what is the PowerPoint? What will give me the strength? I've heard tapes and I've listened to people talk about like the psychology of the setting of a negotiation and what part of the table you should sit on and whether you should sit with your back to the window or the back to the door. And although all of that stuff is relevant, there's no way you're going to get a guy to give you $1 million building for 500,000 because of like the position you take on the table or whether or not you lean back or lean forward or raise your voice or don't raise your voice. But some of these subtleties of like looking for the position, at least it helps you. One of the tricks that I learned when I was a kid was when you have a very special point that you want to make in a negotiation, when you have a point that you want to bring forward, rather than raising your voice to make the point, you lower your voice. And so when you come to the point of saying, I do not wish to pay $1 million for this block of flats, my offer to you is $500,000, you would say that almost at a whisper. And as you whisper, what happens is that everybody has to lean forward or bring their energy into your pattern of influence in order to hear what you're saying. And so, again, this is one of those subtleties or one of those oblique methods that you can use to establish a sense of sobriety, serenity, a sense of control. And so you would say, my offer to you is $500,000. And they go, what? What did you say? And again, you repeat it even lower still. My offer to you is $500,000. What did you say? Finally. And so you've got them in there. You've sucked them in, so to speak. You've gained their attention. When a person talks to you or when a person is listening to you, their mind is usually someplace else. It is very rare, let's say, when you're having a conversation with another person, that they can attend to what you're saying for more than like 10 to 15 seconds at a time before an answer coming into their own mind or a distraction or some kind of interruption to their consciousness. And so when you lower your voice, you gain their attention. Another technique that you may wish to use is, prior to going into any negotiation or any contractual discussion, is to see it in your mind's eye as playing through to your own satisfaction. In other words, you're kind of running the mental tape of your consciousness prior to getting there. It becomes like an affirmation or a visualization of everything going according to plan. And so you would see the people negotiating with you. You would see them agreeing at your price, at your terms, at your conditions. You would see them being happy with it. And you can watch in your mind's eye all the contractual legal stuff going through. Or you can see your boss agreeing to give you the 50% pay rise that you're going in for Monday morning. And so by creating that visualization or by creating that whole thing in your mind's eye, you set up an energy for it to be a reality. It is almost like you project the thought form out ahead of you, and then they have to kind of fit in with it because it is already there at the negotiating table when they show up. And so this idea of visualizing your way through things, you can create it right. You can create it your way. You are the person that is writing the symphony, and they are the people that are going to come and play it. They are playing your tune because you've established what the score is. You've established the musical interlude prior to them getting there. And so it allows you a sense of like cohesiveness. And as you play it through in your mind, you can watch for any problems that may occur. You can begin to look at like, well, what are they going to come up with? What is their answer? If I say this, what is their answer going to be? And if they do answer such and such and such and such, what is my answer going to be? And how am I going to defend myself when they make this point? And how am I going to like establish this alternative reality in their mind and get them to agree? Because it's fine for you to have a reality that's different to theirs, but to make the deal go through, you've got to get them to agree to your reality. And sometimes, of course, that will take time. As we move on from the psychology, we now move into R for relationships. And obviously, for a negotiation to take place, what you need to do is to get the other people to identify with you. You need to get them into a relationship. So as you walk into this refrigerator store, you need to develop a relationship with the salesperson. If you just walk in and the guy says it's $500 for the refrigerator and you say, I'll give you $250, there's no relationship. And so he's bound to say no. However, if you take time to go in and find out his name and find out what his needs are and find out whether or not he has a commission in it or not, if you begin to ask about the refrigerator and you go into all of these details and how does a motor work and what is the weight of the door and how many ice trays and what kind of packaging does it come in and how many, you know, watts of electricity does it use, he's engaged in the relationship. And then when he finishes explaining to you all of this stuff, all you have to do is just sit there and and ah. And the umming and the ahhing is one of your most powerful techniques. And when he says to you, did you understand all of that, you sort of and ah and say, no, I didn't really. And he'll say to you, well, what didn't you understand? I spent 45 minutes explaining to you every minute detail of how this fridge works. I mean, what is it that you don't understand? And you sort of say, well, all of it. I never really understood any of it from the beginning sentence when you talked to me about the ice trays. And then you suck him into going back into the whole thing again. Once he has a commitment with you, once he feels a part of your reality, then it's easier to move him off his reality. So what you're basically trying to do is to establish a relationship. That's why, say, for example, in the Orient, it's so hard to do a deal until you've hung out with the opposition for, like, days and days and days, eating and drinking and, you know, going through endless dinners with them, because they feel this tremendous need for the relationship in order for them to feel secure. As you develop the relationship with the buyer or the seller, you need to let them know that you want to do the deal. You haven't told them at this point that you want to do the deal at half price, but you need to let them know, yes, I'm interested in buying this refrigerator. And so as you go into this, like, I want to buy this refrigerator, the salesman almost automatically begins to think in terms of, like, the commission he's earned, and he goes in his mind and he spends it. And so then when you come up with this whole idea of wanting to pay less, he feels, or she feels, if it's a female salesperson, a sense of loss. They've already spent the commission in their mind, and here you are, you're just about to walk out the door. Or you've negotiated this incredible deal with a corporation, and they've already decided how much profit they're going to make out of you, and then suddenly you've got this incredible psychological tool of your withdrawal. What you're doing is, you're setting it up in their mind that you're going to go for the deal without ever really confirming that you will, and then you're going to play takeaway. And when you play takeaway, they come out of all sorts of panic. And there will be all sorts of, like, negotiable points to stop you coming out of takeaway. The price of the refrigerator includes the trucking fee, the time it's been sitting on the floor, whether it's a shop-soiled item, has it been a demonstration model, it includes the salesman's commission, it includes 101 things. And all of those suddenly come to light when they see you walking away, especially if you've sort of, in very subtle terms, established it in their mind that you want it. And so the whole time it takes you to establish a relationship pays dividends in the end. And if you have to go back to the refrigerator store three times and spend, let's say, 20 minutes each time, it's still only taken you an hour. And if you save $250, that's pretty good money. And so in the whole of this relationship thing, you're looking always to, like, engage their emotion and get them to identify with you. What you're looking at is you're looking for their POV. If you've ever written a film script or you've ever read a film script, POV stands for point of view. And so you're looking through their eyes in the situation. And again, you're looking for the subtlety of, like, where are their emotions? What are their needs? One final point in relationships is this, that if you ever have to negotiate in a group, let's say, for example, an entire department in a corporation has to go off and negotiate with a factory or something, then appoint a spokesman and have the other members of the group silent. Because what happens is, if you don't do that, invariably one member of the group will shoot down your position or will give away a vital piece of information. It's easy for you among yourself to pass notes across a negotiating table or to say to the opposition, excuse me, but we need to have a meeting in the hallway. But if you have to negotiate in groups, and I hate to do that, be sure that one person is the negotiator and the rest of the people are the backup. Because if you don't, you can get yourself into tremendous trouble. And I've been in negotiations for, like, large sums of money, corporate negotiations, where a group of board of directors did the negotiating. And it's been absolutely wonderful to watch them blow themselves out of the water, where one guy says one price and somebody says something totally different. And you could see the disarray in the group. By everybody remaining silent and the spokesman doing the talking, they come out of, or you come out of, a united front. Finally, as we look at profit, we look at O for originality. And there's no need for me to go into great details about how to be original. But every deal is a component of many, many factors. And you can usually find some original way of bartering or changing or exchanging or giving a concession in return for some other concession that will allow the deal to go through. It's mostly a matter of your craftiness, and it's also mostly a matter of you looking at all of the ramifications. As you begin to develop that kind of originality, you'll find that you don't necessarily always have to part with money to make something happen, or you don't necessarily have to concede in order for something to happen. You can come up with an incredibly original idea, which will be a benefit to the other people, but is not a loss to you. As you look at life, remember, everything is negotiable. And everything is just somebody's point of view. Your point of view is just as real as theirs, and once you go beyond the uncomfortableness of challenging the status quo, you can save yourself thousands upon tens of thousands of dollars by moving into negotiations with all the subtlety and craftiness that is a part of your natural expertise in life. Rockefeller once said, "Making money is serious business," and it is. And the money you save by negotiating, you can use to enrich your life and the lives of your loved ones. Thank you.
This has been an Australian production from the Recorded Book Corporation and is one of the titles from our powerful Stuart Wilde Mastery of Life series. The titles in the series are Creating Miracles in Your Life, Developing More Personal Power, The Subtle Art of Negotiation, Developing the Sixth Sense, Developing More Self-Confidence, Loving Relationships, Dream Power, Good Sex, Mastery of Money, The Way of the Warrior. If you have any comments and would like to receive our complete catalogue or would like further information on Stuart Wilde, who frequently tours and lectures, do write to us at the address on the cover.